A very good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen.
I, Dr. Narendra, along with my colleague, Dr. Sapna, will be the MCs for next two sessions. We hope the last 2 days of the conclave have been quite informative and interesting. Welcome you back, the scholars of great erudition and galaxy of intellectuals, to make this afternoon not just wonderful, but a day full of learning and new experiences.
Narendra, are you aware there are various ethical codes for medical technology industry globally?
Yeah, Sapna. While preparing for this session, I have read through certain ethical association of the medical technology industry. Like in Canada, there is a national association for medical technology industry called MEDEC. In Australia, there is a medical technology association too. Globally, there are various associations which we are just not aware of.
Oh, really? I was totally unaware. It's good that we hear about it from our experts from the next session on code of conduct for medical technology industry, legal and ethical compliances.
William James Mayo famously said, "The aim of medicine is to prevent disease and to prolong life. But the ideals of medicine is to eliminate the need of physician, and medical technology is doing the same."
But here comes the role of ethics. It is in knowing the difference between what right you have and what is right to do. And our scholars will enlighten us regarding this. So for this session, I would like to call upon our chairperson for the session, Dr. Harshvardhan Singh, an executive director of Brookings India. May I request you, sir, to please join the stage?
The panelists for the session are our luminary faculty, Dr. Shakti Kumar Gupta, Medical Superintendent, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, Center of Ophthalmic Sciences, AIIMS, New Delhi. Now, with much more honor, I request you, sir, please join the stage.
Welcome, sir. Now, I would like to invite one of the highbrow and depth surgeon of All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi, Dr. Deepak Agarwal, Professor of Neurosurgery and Chairman of Computer Facility at AIIMS, New Delhi. Sir, I request you to kindly join the stage. Thank you, sir.
I would like to call upon an adroit leader of GlaxoSmithKline Pharmaceutical Limited, Mr. A. Vaidish, Vice President of South Asia and Managing Director India, GlaxoSmithKline. Sir, you may please join the stage.
Welcome, sir. Our last panelist for the session is Mr. Manoj Gopalakrishna, CEO at HCL Healthcare Noida.
Thank you, sir. Lastly, I will call upon the moderator of the session, Dr. Sanjeev Singh, Medical Superintendent, Amrita Institute of Medical Sciences, Kochi, Kerala. Sir has received prestigious British Medical Journal Award 2016, South Asia, in the category of Infectious Disease Initiative of the Year.
Welcome, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Before I call upon for the keynote address, I will say a few words about our chairperson. Dr. Harshvardhan Singh is a PhD in economics from Oxford University, where he went as a Rhodes Scholar from India. He has worked for over 3 decades on international trade policy, development, infrastructure regulation, and global governance. He is an executive director, Brookings India, and senior fellow of the Council on Emerging Market Enterprises. Dr. Singh was deputy director general at World Health Organization for 8 years. I'm sorry, World Trade Organizations. In India, Dr. Singh was economic advisor and then secretary of the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India. He's a senior fellow at International Institute for Sustainable Development. He's also a member of Global Agenda Council on Trade and FDI. Sir, may I request you to kindly come on the dais?
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. Welcome back. Hopefully, the discussion will stimulate you quite a lot. I thank Dr. Shakti Gupta and the organizers for inviting me. When he invited me for this, I mentioned to him that though I have a doctor in front of my name, it's not related to medical doctor. But since I have background in regulation, I'm chairing a national committee on standards. I'm from an area where standards are very important. I guess that was the basis for him encouraging me to share my thoughts with you today. I too have read a lot about codes of conduct on medical technologies in addition to other technologies. What I have tried to do is to share some thoughts with you on some of the key abiding factors which prevail in such codes, what's happening in the context of that codes, so that we in India keep in mind the framework of factors which we need to actually equip ourselves in terms of to become more and more effective over time. Code of conduct for medical technologies is a journey. It's a journey because the regulatory concerns keep evolving. Technologies expand in scope, competencies for producing or operating the technology needs to improve. The legal system and underlying processes need to be updated to be relevant in current context, and the context keeps evolving even as I speak. Since this is a journey, there are people on different parts of this road. And this implies that some aspects can be taken off the shelf from other nations, international organizations like WHO or the ISO. Also means that any system, especially in a developing economy, would have gaps to fill. And it's from that perspective that I want to share my thoughts with you today. Because reading these codes of conduct at any point of time will not equip you adequately, because things are evolving in certain ways with technological changes and ethical considerations also changing. So India actually has changed its regulation vis-a-vis medical devices very, very recently. And in conformity with international standards, which has made its regime far more complex than it was, which doesn't mean that the complexity is not required. It's required, but we need to master that complexity. Medical devices, on which people focus on, is only a part of medical technologies, not the whole part, but an important part. An important insight in economics of technology, and therefore the functioning of technology in the 1970s, was that technology is not just hardware, it's also software. And I don't mean WhatsApp. It covers diagnostics, monitoring devices, drug delivery devices, instruments, new technologies such as nanotechnology, robotics, artificial intelligence, and apps on smartphones. So the ethical and legal issues for established technologies and new and evolving technologies need not be the same. That's the first part we have to keep in mind. Another important aspect is to recognize that there is a chain of activities involved with medical technologies. Linked to the chain of activities is a chain or sequence of policy or policy makers. So it's like a web which we have to really try and see how to make sense of that. Where is the priority? What are the key levers which are involved? So those involved in these two chains include producers of technology, users of technology, patients, regulators, and other stakeholders. So when we take a look at this, the fact that this is a journey where the journey is not complete, in some sense, it cannot be, because the destination itself keeps moving, and these different aspects which are involved in medical technologies, we can identify some key questions to help guide us to understand and address the issues prevailing in the Indian situation. And I specifically request Dr. Sanjeev Singh to keep in mind these questions. And there may be several others, but one is to identify the gaps in the existing systems with respect to ethical and legal requirements. When I say present system, I mean the Indian system. And the processes to address these gaps. Is the scope and gap of legal and ethical considerations changing? If so, how to prepare for it? Is there a priority ordering of what needs to be addressed first? We can consider something in the context of a low-hanging fruit, something which will happen easily or early with our efforts. And if within the low-hanging fruit, there is one with very high level of impact. What are the linked steps needed to develop this process in a consistent manner? That's what a code of conduct is all about. Are the relevant standards and concerns specific to local conditions? And do they take account of operational constraints? One other important thought is that if you got to meet the requirements of ethical and legal principles, there is a key role played by principles of good governance. And that applies to both ethical and legal considerations. What is good governance? Good governance includes aspects such as transparency, inclusive and informed participation of stakeholders. This is where we talked about rights of stakeholders like patients or doctors, etc. It includes conflict of interest issues, cost effectiveness and impact, monitoring the process and performance, reducing risk, basing it on clear and measurable methods, accountability, redressal of concerns. So if we combine the good governance aspects and the gap analysis together with the complexity of a changing world, what are some of the abiding factors in ethical principles? That the tech-based solutions should be safe, effective, including cost-effective, reliable, dependable, with equity and impact. This can also include the importance of patient consent, the extent of the duty to mitigate harm, and responsibility to facilitate access to new medical therapies through public health system. Assessing and reducing or managing risks. And then if we work with new technologies, privacy, hacking, possibility of self-diagnostics, and possibility of harm, these become new concerns which we need to address. And as yet, I don't think we have a framework or a code of conduct. It would be remarkable if in some of the areas where India has actually taken the lead in digital, we could also come out with something on this. Then the new practices in the world of science and technology sometimes systematically violate the existing ethical and legal basis. Due to mass data collection, there are business practices which actually work with large data. To what extent are they violating individual rights? What are the safeguards which are being developed on that? That is a very murky area as yet. And this is changing. This itself is, the business practice itself is evolving. So like Alice in Wonderland, she said, you have to run faster and faster to be in the same place. We need to recognize a major difference between our practices and those of some informed, the more advanced countries. I've lived in both parts. I grew up and I've spent a large part of my life in India, and I've spent a large part of my life in developed economies. And the one difference, and I've been in hospitals in both places, the one difference I see is the extent of information to patients and consideration of their own perspective or keeping them along with you. In India, I think the doctor probably is so busy that he sees it as a drudgery, something which need not be done. Abroad, especially Switzerland, where I spent a lot of time, you would actually never have that kind of situation, and the doctor would explain things to you and take your consent. Since our requirements are not identical to countries which are source of medical technologies, we have to also think of devising our own technologies. It's very difficult when technological frontier is moving. But can we do some kind of priority setting for developing of medical technology? What mechanisms exist to prioritize this process? We go beyond devices, then the ethical factors become even larger. I don't want to make it murkier, but workplace conduct, maintaining confidentiality, accuracy of company records, avoiding conflict of interest, gifts, suspected misconduct, and non-compliance and reporting are just some examples. So once we take a look at this chain, we realize that in order to go further, we require collaboration between different stakeholders. That's where good governance becomes important. That's where rules of conduct become important. And I think we are still work in progress. The varying capacities and levels of preparedness in different parts of a nation become evident in this background. So once again, I go to the gap analysis there. One other aspect is that we have to be much more proactive in developing our own processes. And what is the requirement for those who test new medical technologies in India? Is there a standardized protocol approved by the ethics committee? The previous session was talking about ethics committee and testing, etc. It becomes very important that this applies in whichever context we are, and the session did recognize some gaps there. On legal requirements, there is a set of wider considerations similarly, and the laws and regulation to consider particularly relevant to medical technology industry are huge number. If you look at medical technology, safety, quality and performance laws, advertising promotion laws, data protection laws, anti-corruption, environment, health, safety, competition laws, and a system of review and addressing disputes. To really make it manageable, perhaps we can start with a focus on medical devices, for which India has established a very detailed system. The issues relating to legal compliance for medical devices primarily relate to standards pertaining to health safety, certification, conformity assessment, categorization and management of risk, effectiveness, quality, safety, transparency, sharing of information, training, collaboration, and many other factors which I mentioned in the context of ethics. We do have good governance, again, being important, and there is a global harmonization task force and global medical device nomenclature with established processes and framework which can move us and provide a model towards moving towards harmonization. And that's an area which India is moving towards. However, three considerations are worth keeping in mind. One, there is also a proliferation of voluntary standards and in many instances, private standards. So how does one manage a system there? Quality Council of India has been named as a focal point for private standards in India. And working with them would help very much indeed. Second, the capacities of the institution which verify and certify standards remain limited. As technical complexities increase and scope of issues become more than merely technical in nature. And ethics is very much beyond technical in nature. Three, the regulatory capacities in most developing economies are limited, especially amongst those who regulate. And in particular, where the frontier is moving, they are not even fully aware of what the issues are. So that is a gap where you constantly have to update yourself and inform yourself. And maybe some centralized process of informing the regulators can be there. This gap becomes much more evident as technology evolves over time. Therefore, once again, I hark back on my questions which identified various gaps and emphasize the need to identify and focus on priority issues. With that, I thank you, and I look forward to the discussion.
Thank you very much, sir, for that those illuminating points. I'm not sure whether your wife has ever told you that you're a man with golden voice. Other than the content, I think I was very amazed and enumerated with your voice. That was very, having a fantastic bass.
I'll tell her. But thank you.
But as a think tank, I think he brought very, very relevant points. He brought about the global harmonization task force, the gaps which exist, the deficiencies, the risks, the harms, the ethics, and the other standards. Before we started, we also as a panel have been given a code of conduct of starting on time and finishing on time. So I would request the panel members to kindly be specific and focus on the questions, and we would like to have some audience question as well. I'll start with, thank you very much, Dr. Shakti Gupta, for organizing such a fantastic conclave and getting all the things together. You asked a very relevant question in the previous section of this telemedicine, that 1998 you asked the question and 2017 we are still asking. So is there a code of conduct, because 2005 Government of India started some baseline work on medical technology and medical technology industry code of conduct, and then there is some draft bill which is already existing as medical device bill. So is there anything which is existing right now in the country?
Before coming to the code of conduct, why it is required,
I was talking to actually so many luminaries, and I was scared to know that some draconian laws are coming up actually. How to regulate the industry and how to regulate the medical professionals. But before going for code of conduct, I think let's see why there is a need for collaboration between healthcare professionals and medical technology companies. Collaborations are required for, it is very important and necessary for patient safety and medical innovations. Unless we don't have a synergy between the academia and the medical industry, I don't think much research can be done or new innovation can come up. Another important is that the medical technologies require hands-on training and practice to assure safe and effective use and retraining as medical technologies undergo repeated changes, because the innovations are coming very fast, and one technology which comes today actually that becomes obsolete actually very short and soon actually. Then another important is that why collaboration is required. The physicians, they bring practical field experience and other experience which are vital to development and improvement of medical technology. And it is also required to design effective clinical trials of devices. But the question is that, is there any conflict of interest? No, when we talk about conflict of interest, about the synergy between the say, medical technology and the medical professionals, healthcare professionals, it is apprehension that there may, that the healthcare professionals might base clinical decisions are on their relationship with the company rather than on the best interest of their patients. These are the apprehensions I am talking about. And another conflict of interest appears to be, there could be a relationship between physician and industry which have come under the scrutiny of lawmakers, the prosecutors and the public. Because now it is being debated day in and day out, and large number of news items comes that maybe the medical professionals are being dictated by medical industry and vice versa. Then question comes, why there is a need for code of conduct? Because code of conduct protects a culture of integrity and ethical business practices across the industry, and it ensures high standards of behavior across the industry to enable patient and healthcare professional confidence in dealing with the industry and its products, and also helps industry ensure that all decisions made by healthcare professionals, they are based on the best interest of their individual patients and not on their relationship with the medical technology company. And another important is that it also helps in extending patient protection with greater transparency and clear demarcations of industry relationships. Then another is that it also clearly spells terms for training, terms for educational conferences, terms for entertainment, consulting, arrangements, some royalty, or grants and donations, and all other code compliances. But no question comes when we talk about the training and capacity building programs. Can one survive on their own? Because industry and the medical profession have to join together for capacity building programs in our country. So I don't think we can think of working in isolation are not joining with the medical industry for bringing a change in the society.
Thank you very much, sir. That was very illuminating and very exhaustive. Dr. Shakti Gupta did mention about there are many draconian laws which are going to come, and there are all work in progress. So I would like to ask Dr. Deepak, you were there in that earlier session, and there is a new government order which has recently come, similar to draconian law, that from the Department of Chemicals and Fertilizers, National Pharmaceutical Pricing Authority, they say that hospital should not, if it is a single-use device, it needs to be single-use and it cannot be reused, and we need to also be transparent. Neurosurgical and otherwise cardiology does use a lot of these devices. So what would be your take on this?
Thank you, sir, for that very pertinent question. Actually, I think we should be very, very cautious when we look at this law, because majority of our population is poor and pays out of pocket. So it's a big issue in India, and all these laws also and whatever goes either is done blindly copying the West or because of industry pressure. For example, I'll tell you what we are doing in AIIMS. AIIMS is not a small institute, we all know that. It has a 2,000 crore budget, which is bigger than the health budget of a lot of state governments in India. So despite that, despite this huge amount of budget, we have to improvise and reuse a lot of stuff which is single use only. I'll give you some examples. In neurosurgery itself, we have ICP sensors which are single use by Codman, which cost 35,000 a piece. The company said it's single use. We re-sterilize them and again put it. Because unless we do it, this trauma center will go bankrupt. 35,000 for each patient, you're just putting a catheter in. There is no way government can keep spending this all across India. So we keep reusing it till the readings come wrong or the tip gets damaged, and then we put in a new one. On the other end of the spectrum, ventilator circuits costing just 200 rupees, we reuse them simply because they have to be changed every 48 hours. And if you have 20 patients in the ICU, you can imagine the enormous cost over the year. So we take a conscious decision, taking the cost effectiveness in play, seeing the bigger patient load, and deciding that yes, it makes prudence and prudent sense to keep reusing them so that policies and protocols remain in place. What is the protocol? Protocol is that this thing should be changed, the ventilator circuit should be changed every 48 hours. Rather than saying we'll only put in new circuit, then that new circuit might remain there for weeks together. Similarly, for ICP catheter, the protocol is every patient with severe energy should have an ICP catheter. So the compromise is reuse rather than breaking the protocol. If you put in a law that no one will not be using, then what will happen over 1 month or 2 months when the stock goes down? We'll say, okay, whenever we get the catheter, we'll use it. So I think in the larger interest, in the greater good, looking at our socioeconomic status, it is imperative that we continue reusing wherever we can. Obviously, ethically, that is the bottom line which we are keep talking in this conclave, that ethics is the core of it. And the perspective of not only the doctors, the patient has to be kept in mind. Because yes, if you feel, and the doctor can sense when a patient is paying or not, well, or whenever the patient is paying or something, we tell them that this catheter is very expensive. If you want a fresh one, we'll have to pay for it. Otherwise, we're going to put in a used one. 99% of the patients will say we have no problem with putting in a reused one if it is free. Even we are all from middle class, we would say put in a reused catheter inside me if I save 35,000 in the catheter itself. So I'll just end with, there's a saying in Hindi, nazar hatane se nazrana nahi badalta. Nazar hatane se nazrana nahi badalta. Nazariya badalne se nazrana badalta. So your perspective has to change to actually understand what is going on in 360 degrees.
Thank you so much, sir. From telemedicine to neurosurgery to Galib, I think it every session of yours you emerge as a new personality. But I think what sir said was very relevant. Unfortunately, Government of India is bringing all developed nations regulations in a developing country which is still very resource limited. Sir, you wanted to share a few thoughts?
Yeah, no, just a thought and maybe more as a question. You mentioned that something is cheap, therefore we use it, we don't reuse it. So the criteria appear to be cost. To me, the criteria should be, if you are sterilizing it, is it as good or as safe as something which is new? So it should not be the cost at all. Even if it's 35,000 and you cannot really bring it into such a way that the patient is can be harmed, then it should be new. That's the way I feel.
That is what we would all want. Unfortunately, it's all an industry-driven practice. When you ask the company, they will never give you in writing that even if you re-sterilize, it is safe for you.
So suppose you do some kind of data.
Yes, we have done the studies. Internally, we have done the study.
Therefore, you can show to the policy maker that, look, this actually is as good as that. That's the point.
So very interestingly, National Accreditation Board of Hospital, NABH, when they used to assess hospital, they realized every hospital has the same practice. So they have put that as a standard, and that's a country standard. And Department of Cardiology in All India Institute, their professor Sandeep Mishra has come up with a publication recently, which has been published in, I think, February in Indian Journal of Cardiology, where they have demonstrated the outcomes are better with reusing. If you follow this good sterilization practices, it is, and the cost is definitely shared. So we'll shift gears. Dr. Vaidish comes from a pharmaceutical background, and so there's so much of discussion within the country of not of standard quality drugs, counterfeit drugs, spurious drugs. Now again, Government of India is coming up with another so-called draconian law of completely generic, and then there will be no brown. So how do you think this, the whole code of conduct issue and the quality of drugs and safety towards the patient would be addressed?
My personal view is that I think India is pretty unique. As always, India is unique in most of the things, that it's also unique in healthcare. See, when you have 65% of your expenses are out of pocket, where you are asking a compromised, emotionally and physically compromised patient to make a financial decision. So you are talking about a completely a different kind of a paradigm that we are all dealing with. So what we call it as a healthcare, there are six P's, right? You have a patient, you have a physician, you have providers, you have policymakers, and you have playmakers. Now what happens is, each one of them have their own interest on how do they want to serve the patient. But unfortunately, some of them have got conflicting interest. For example, a payer like insurance wants to reduce the payment towards the procedure, where the provider thinks that I need X amount of money to pay for the procedure, right? So there's a conflict, inherent conflict. Similarly, playmakers like companies, devices or a drug companies, they are invested money in discoveries and they want to make sure they get a proper return, because there are investors who put money in those companies, they need to get standard returns. Now the question here is that these are all conflicts that you are talking about. We don't have a proper rules of engagement amongst the stakeholders. Unlike in rest of the world, large portion of healthcare is run by government. Even if you take Canada as the highest level, where the Canada full, and similarly UK, most of the healthcare. So there is a rules of engagement is defined very well, and where you can err or the code of conduct, everything is well established. No. Cutting it short, now that's a basis on which we are talking about. Second is that in Indian context, if you look at it, because it's been privatized, a large portion is run by private. The quality that you talked about, I'm just quickly moving on to the question that we talk about. It's quite unfortunate that there are manufacturers who sell products or manufacture high quality products for the purpose of export, because US FDA wants you to give you the high quality generic products. But when it comes down to supplying to India, typically not many of them would tend to deliver the same quality of generics. So that's why the brands played a very big role in terms of giving that quality assurance. So for example, you have a what we call it as a manufacturing standards of WHO manufacturing standard. Tell me how many companies have WHO manufacturing standards. Bioequivalent study has to be done for every drug. Not every drug has got a bioequivalent study for whatever is being marketed. So before, I think government direction is not bad. Frankly, in my opinion, every patient should get an affordable pricing. I think that all of us would agree. What's very important is that we need to ensure the bioequivalent study is done. Everybody should have an equal footing, deliver the right quality. At any point of time, if I pick up after a year an antibiotic, amoxicillin, clavulanate, it should have a similar bioavailability for any other generic that you take. Today, if you do that, I suspect you may not find that. So I would be very careful before we go down the path, generic, branded generic, or quality is bad. The first and foremost, we need to establish. I guess that DCGI is looking at those kind of practices. And similarly, the retailers, if you're going to give the power from a doctors to the retailers to decide what drugs to be given to the patients, I would be very careful. You know, it's not a good idea to give it today that doctor knows what patients to be taken care of. He or she knows I am responsible for the patient. Suddenly, it goes to somebody else whose primary aim is to profit optimization or a maximization. So we got to be careful whether we are pushing too much toward the, instead of trying to bring down the cost, you may end up in generating more problem for us, correct? So I'm quite sure that a lot of input that has gone into government, industry has given their views, Medical Council of India has given the views. So I guess it's a good debate that has happened, but I think it's also now right time for focus on quality, focus on manufacturing practices. See, if you're talking about data integrity that US FDA talking about, it's a simple phenomenon, but we don't bother about it. Now, because US FDA is pushing it, same thing, we should do it to our population also. Why only US population should have those quality standards? Why not India, right? And then we talk about cost reductions, given that framework. Otherwise, you will end up in having a low quality drugs available to common man, where you will take an antibiotic or antipsychotic drugs that you will take, which suddenly it goes halfway down, it doesn't work. You don't want to be in that situation, a population of a billion. Good place that we are in, at the right time, I think we need to have a good consultation and a good rules of engagement, rather than taking a random decision saying, now the stents have to be brought down to 25,000 rupees or 26,000. It may be right, but I'm not sure whether, why does it have to be shocks, right? It can be a good rules of engagement of people sharing the data, having a good conversation.
Thank you very much, sir. It's very rightly said, the Schedule M and the definition of our drugs and devices is, it's itself is so confusing, that they have included so much within this that we also know what does fall into medical technology as a drug or as a device. I would like to ask Mr. Manoj, since you come from a Wharton School of Business and you have already worked in so many blue chip companies, London School of Economics in 2014 came up with this article mentioning that with each technology there's a cost. There's a code of conduct, but each technology, there's a cost which adds to the patient. And with an unpublished work which we did, we find that 42% of the bills of the patient has a medical device featuring into it. So is it very relevant to say that with each technology, the cost also increases and that the patient will keep paying for it?
Thank you very much for that question, and thank you for having me on the panel. In fact, this is a question which I have been getting in many of the panels related to the medical technology. So today, actually, after spending almost like 2 decades in the medical technology industry, I am actually not part of it. So I can take a ringside view and then possibly answer maybe what you have asked. I think medical technology, we all need to understand very clearly that it's an industry driven by innovation. And that innovation comes especially in terms of reducing the procedure time, improving the clinical outcomes, making procedures less invasive, and then also improving the patient comfort and so on. But what's important is that every innovation, is it really incremental or is it breakthrough? Are we really, the question of pain comes if it is improving clinical outcomes significantly, if it's improving patient comfort significantly. There is a rationale for maybe having an health economics advantage by taking that particular innovation. So the most important question that we need to ask is that, is it an incremental innovation which is really pushing up the cost, or is it a breakthrough innovation which is leading to redefining the outcome, improving patient comfort, and improving clinicians' comfort? All that is contributing to the cost increase. So what we definitely lack when we look at medical technology innovation is that, do we have systematic way of doing health economic assessment and health technology assessment? The backup for that in our country possibly is limited. So many of the new technologies which we talk about, we don't really talk with some of those studies in perspective. So that's the reason why sometimes you end up pushing innovations which are incremental and push up the cost. So that's something which is avoidable. And something which is really breakthrough is something which we should be investing in if you are looking at improving the outcomes.
Thank you very much, sir. I think Make in India possibly is going to bring that answer. Are there any audience question? Yes, ma'am. Can you introduce yourself and to whom you would like to ask the question?
The question is just one that we were all talking about making things affordable for the poor, but nobody addressed the question that reuse was a problem mainly because it was also being rebuilt and that it was meant to push up the profit of hospitals. I'm surprised that nobody here addressed that question because in AIIMS can talk about reuse because they're doing it for making things affordable because they're not billing the patient. But a private hospital where FDA Maharashtra found this happening, it was being reused not just three times, but probably they said on an average of 8 to 11 times. And each time was being billed afresh. So I would be grateful if the panel could address that question too, about you know profit being the motive for reuse.
Since I come from a private institute, I would like to just, I'll give it to you, sir. That at least, I don't know, the Times of India raided only these three institutes and the ED raided and the Times of India covered it. And it was unfortunate that it was billed at the same price. But most of the institute would, if they're using it 8 times, they divide it 8 times and build it accordingly. And that is what, but if the practice is different, I think that definitely needs to change. Point well taken.
Yes, I agree with you. Actually, what I have seen, because I mainly worked in the government sector, very little time in the private sector, but what happens is that you bill the person in whom you put it the first time, and in a poor or indigent patient, which is also being taken care of by your hospital or because of you, you will put in the reusable thing. And not bill, obviously, because that's a poor patient. That is the standard practice across all private hospitals. It is, I would say, completely illegal to bill a patient and use a reusable. There is no question, so there is no, nobody's going to put a counterpoint to this. It's completely illegal, and the moment somebody comes out of it, it should be punished. So we all agree on that. The only question is, if a patient cannot pay, can we reuse the reusable device?
Yeah, please.
Actually, it's quite an interesting point. I'm talking about, I've been in devices in the past experience of mine. I've seen this quite happening. It's what I always call ethics is not a one word ethics. It's an ethical dilemma. When you talk about 90% of the time, people do the right things. People know whether it's right or wrong. I think it's a dilemma that comes in where people are caught with two goods to deal with. One is to say, that I need to take care of the patient. The other one is that, can I, for example, reuse at the same time protecting the interests of the patient. And in this case, the dilemma that these hospitals face, I'm not supporting hospitals, I'm not supporting the correct, is the fact that if you look at a procedure, most of the hospitals are private hospitals. They compete with each other for procedure package and cost and all those stuff. So they end up in having a cap on the package. So they want to figure out how do I optimize my procedure cost that goes into this. So they tend to look at opportunities for reuse. Now the companies will not allow you to reuse because as per the FDA norms, you are under guarantee saying that only one use I can guarantee this product can work. I cannot guarantee a second use or 100 use. Correct? That's why many companies won't even give you saying that whether you can reuse it or not. It can be reused. Some product can be used 10 times. So many of these hospitals, they know some of these products can be used 10 times. They put it into disinfectant, they re-sterilize it, and they find it's okay, right? I guess it is legally, is it correct? Absolutely not correct. But is it a dilemma that they are resolving it by this way? I think that's what they're getting caught by FDA going in and not. But let me tell you, given a choice, they would not reuse. But it's every procedure is so much of competition. So they're all looking at how do I figure out, maximize my cost efficiency. This is what I observed. I'm not saying this is what they do, but I observed in various places, they are under pressure to reuse.
Yeah. Thank you. I think it's quite a complex issue which you have raised. And the answers to me, in fact, the first two answers themselves show different kinds of billings which are involved. One, the full recovery of the cost, and then marginal cost is zero, therefore I don't charge you. AIMS, given its inclination towards public service, perhaps more than some others, may use that kind of billing. Another model was that if I use it 8 times, I divide it by 8. But there was another thought with that either in strict terms is illegal. So two issues arise. I had used criteria of transparency, effectiveness and cost effectiveness. If we combine these, first of all, if you're doing this, it must be done transparently. And if there is a law which actually prevents you from doing it, that law must be re-examined if there is data to show success with that. So there is a basis to re-examine that law itself. That's what, no law is cast in stone that it cannot be changed if there is evidence to show that it's wrong. The second part is that you, once you are being transparent, you decide what your costing strategy is going to be. It could be full first and then zero, or it could be divided by X. And that the patient must be told that this is what I'm doing. Maybe the first one can be charged more because it's new. But if I go by your data and the article you talked about, maybe the later ones need to be charged more. So everything has to be done based on criteria. That's the point I'm making, which are logical. And ethics includes functioning on the criteria to address the dilemmas.
Right, so point what? Yes, madam. Just one second, madam. This gentleman has approached all panelists and he has delayed his flight because he wanted to ask this question. So I'll ask. So he basically, though it is restricted to medical gas and pipeline system, but maybe I'll ask Mr. Manoj to take this. Is there any tender specification and some preventive measures to stop unethical issues in tendering? If I can just make it broader, not just limited to MGPS.
I think the public procurement program generally works well once we have laid out standards. So I think the whole question is about, do we have a good technical committee who deals with it transparently, put the standards, and then use that standard to really do the procurement. So quite often, the problem comes in defining the standards. So I think that itself goes through a questionable process, which may lead to shortlisting of one or two companies rather than the the whole spectrum of companies. So I think the most important step is that who is really framing the standards and who is really validating that, and then based on that is the procurement process happening. So to a larger extent, it's a question of how do we define the process. So I think there has been a good experiment in India, which was years back, Tamil Nadu Medical Supplies Corporation. So in fact, in many states, state government was facing with huge problems related to public procurement of devices and drugs. And this was the first state government to corporatize the whole procurement program. And then there was very high level of transparency. And even after maybe 10, 15 years, that's fairly well maintained. And now Rajasthan has copied it. I believe Karnataka is copying it. And Government of India is thinking about forming something in the line of a Tamil Nadu Medical Supplies Corporation. Again, the work was defining the standards, laying the process in a very transparent way so that it's all in the public domain.
Yeah, last question.
Out of my experience as OIC of medical stores into largest hospitals in the armed forces, my question is very simple, that in the public sector, our problem is limited resources and the goal of achieving 100% satisfaction of availability of drugs, because we don't charge in the armed forces any patient for any medicine at all. So for our procurement system, we lay down the quality criteria and consultation with the HODs of all the departments. A golden circle of 70 to 100 acceptable manufacturers is created and it is displayed in the notice board outside the procurement section. It is also circulated to all the bidders. And no one who is not an authorized distributor for that manufacturer is allowed to bid. In that way, what we do away with, which needs to be done away with in all agencies which are dealing with drug prescription, is monopoly. The moment you prescribe a branded drug, you are creating monopoly. I have seen with my personal experience that monopoly is the biggest bugbear. The moment you create and encourage healthy competition with transparency, the drug procurement prices come down. They come down in a public sector hospital also because of the volume of purchasing. But I am convinced that if an honest private practitioner also hands over, along with a generic prescription, a printed list of acceptable manufacturers to the educated patient or even to the uneducated one, which he can go and show in a pharmacy, then we can certainly achieve a win-win situation where the patient walks out with a generic drug prescription, legally valid, sensible. It cannot be misinterpreted either, because trade name prescriptions get misinterpreted and sometimes wrong drug is issued from the counter. Secondly, with a list of approved manufacturers, even an OPD patient is assured of choice. And with that choice, he can choose an economical solution. Whether he goes and buys it from a private pharmacy or from a hospital-run pharmacy is a second question, which can then be empowering the patient. So this is my suggestion and question, that this is a solution which we have been invoking for the past several years and it can be replicated.
I think point well taken, madam, your question, and you also answered it, so that was perfect. With this,
just one. Just coming back to Reema's question, actually, I have been associated with the cardiac center actually for 5 years as an additional medical superintendent, seeing the thing actually. Initially, when we started this bypass surgery in AIIMS in 1988, we started a package for bypass surgery about 90,000 rupees. Which includes the imported this all catheters and consumables and other things actually. Of course, it does not include the cost of the manpower and other things. And with the volume of services, when the number of patient went up, so because of the competition, we brought down the price from 90,000 to 70,000. Then again, we reviewed this actually about 5 years back. And then actually, again, because of the number of cases which are going up, we brought down the price of bypass surgery in AIIMS as on today is 60,000. Now, the second question is that reuse of the this catheters and other thing, that is a big actually dilemma and is a challenge actually basically. Are we want to bring down the cost? That is the one issue. Or are we compromising with the quality? But I think more studies needs to be required actually whether the reusers are not causing much complication or other thing. or other effects actually. So I think only one paper will not justify that actually. Maybe we have to do much more studies to justify whether we can use reuse it or not. But as in today, if given a choice to me, that this is a catheter which is used costs about say 80,000 rupees, and this is a reusable which costs 50,000, I will prefer that 80,000 rupees. So that is your.
So as a as a code of conduct, the organizing committee, out of six people who are here, two people who belong outside, they have booked the air ticket, and they are not changing the air ticket. So we need to finish this on time, and we need to. So I'll ask the think tank, Dr. Harshvardhan Singh, to make the closing remarks, and we'll close the
session. Thank you very much. I think we had an interesting discussion and participation from the audience. What I would like to close with is some key factors which have come out from the discussion, and link it also to the good governance criteria. So we talked about standards. So the standards for new, some standards prescribed by manufacturers need not necessarily be the relevant standards. And if there is a basis to question them, then the standard itself is a process of evolution. That combined with the kind of pricing, but whatever is the pricing or standard, some kind of an objective comparator and transparency of what is being done, keeping the patient informed all the time, is extremely important. And in that context, then the issue becomes one of what kind of collaborative mechanisms need to be taken into account, which not only deal with these at the time kind of situation, but also the development of a process in a manner where you move towards making healthcare affordable while maintaining requisite quality standards in a transparent manner. That is the key, and in that we should always have a process of review as part of the internal process of formulation of policy and code of conduct. Code of conduct, every good code of conduct has a possibility of review. And if there is a basis for review, it should be conducted in a timely manner. Timeliness is another good governance aspect. So if you just look at issues of good governance as the basis for ethics as well as legal, I think you'll go a long way down this road. Thank you.
Over to you.
Thank you, sir. Chairperson, sir, to kindly felicitate our valued panelists.
Now I request Dr. Deepak Agarwal. Sir, please.
I request Mr. A. Vaidish to please come for felicitations, sir.
I request Mr. Manoj Gopalakrishna for the token of gratitude.
I request our chairperson, sir, to felicitate our moderator, Dr. Sanjeev Singh. I request Dr. Girish Tyagi, Secretary Delhi Medical Council, to please come on the stage and felicitate our chairperson, sir.